tick-tock, tick-tock. Before you know it, the end of the year will be here, so remember to use your vision benefits before they expire. Schedule eye exams today for the whole family by visiting pearlvision.com. Pearlvision will cover the cost of your insurance copay or eye exam, plus they accept all major vision plans, including EyeMed. Valid prescription required. Valid at participating locations. Restrictions apply. Taxes extra. See store for details. Ends 12/31/23. Exams available at the Independent Doctors of Optometry at or next to Pearl Vision. Some doctors employed by Pearl Vision.
Calling all night owls. When you've got the after dark munchies, Amigos is here for you to satisfy your late night cravings. Put your hunger to bed with Amigos' new 8 to close specials. Only $5 for two crisp meat burritos, two cheesy burritos, or one of each, for those who can't decide. You heard right. Two of our favorite late night sellers, crisp meats or cheesies, for just $5. Head to Amigos, where flavor never sleeps.
If you really like this episode, please support our podcast by going to patreon.com/truecrimewives and get lots of great extras. On The Good Wife's Guide to True Crime, we discuss crimes that some may find disturbing. Listener discretion is advised.
Since 1989, there have been over 2,000 exonerations of innocent inmates in the United States. The Innocence Project reports that 2-5% of incarcerated people are innocent. In the United States, there are about 2 million people that are incarcerated. So if only 2% of those people are in fact innocent, that would be about 40,000 wrongfully convicted people in prison. And Texas has been the leader in the number of people that it exonerates because of evidence that they are innocent. Since 2010, more than 200 people have been exonerated in Texas. That's more than 2 times as many as any other state. Tonight, we're going to share the case of someone that we believe has been wrongfully convicted and deserves a new trial based on evidence that appears to have suspicious involvement from the law enforcement officials who investigated. We'll be talking tonight about the murder of Stacey Stites and the wrongful imprisonment of Rodney Reed.
He killed them both out of jealousy.
That's what they wanted you to believe.
Judge said guilty on a make-believe trial. Slapped the sheriff on the back with a smile and said, supper's waiting at home and I've got to get to it.
Get out of here.
That's the night that the lights were out.
Get out of here.
That's the night that they hung an innocent man.
Raymond.
Well, don't trust the southern old backwoods southern lawyer. Cause the judge in the town's got blood.
Bastrop County Sheriff says they found the body of a woman along the dirt road of 1441. Now, let me tell you, this morning, 19-year-old Stacey Lee Stites was reported missing and never arrived at work.
In 2006, a small documentary film team helped expose how an innocent man ended up on Texas's death row.
But my personal opinion when I heard that she had been killed was that Fennell had done it immediately. And I know a number of people around here that felt the same way.
It soon became apparent that the case against Rodney Reed was not just a small town affair.
And I believe the state knew about it. I believe the district attorney for Bastrop knew about it. I believe the sheriff's department knew about it. And I believe the Bastrop police department knew about it. And I do believe they covered that up. They did not want a fellow officer implicated.
In the past 13 years, the evidence has continued to mount in favor of Rodney Reed's innocence.
A Georgetown police sergeant is spending the night behind bars. Jimmy Fennell Jr. is accused of sexually assaulting a woman he detained.
His guilty pleas today could play a major role in the appeal process of convicted murderer Rodney Reed.
Key witnesses have recanted crucial testimony.
Did Roberto Bayardo make missteps that hindered justice in some of the most high-profile crime? A man within days of execution now awaiting word of an appeal after Bayardo clarified his conclusions on when that woman died.
Key law enforcement officials who oversaw the initial investigation have been charged and convicted for their own misconduct.
The man who oversaw the Reed investigation, Bastrop Sheriff Richard Hernandez, who also turned out to be a dirty cop and pled guilty to 6 felonies.
And critical scientific medical evidence has been discovered that essentially exonerates Rodney Reed.
He had been
face down for five or more hours in one position before she was turned over to the new position. And she was dead around midnight. She was already dead.
Yet instead of exonerating Reed or even retrying him under fair conditions, the Texas courts have decided to set a November 20th execution date for this year.
Hey folks, it's time to grab your glass of wine because the Good Wives, Fancy, Colleen, and Christina are about to serve up another true crime case.
Well, a little while back, we talked about a case that we felt was imminent in getting the story out because a man's life hung in the balance, and that was Rodney Reed. And it really did hang in the balance, and luckily his execution was stayed. Rodney Reed has been on death row for 22-plus years for the murder of his lover, Stacey Stites, a murder he says he did not commit. And Reed was set to be executed on November 20th, but because of the public, such as us and others, he has been granted an indefinite stay. And now that's going through the process to get a new trial.
Reed has exhausted 9 appeals and had 2 stays of execution, but his attorney, Bryce Benjet from the Innocence Project, claims a jury or judge has never heard all the evidence. In the next 2 episodes, we'll be discussing this case and the huge miscarriage of justice taking place in a very small town in Texas going all the way back to 1996. Now, I think Bryce is actually, since he's part of the Innocence Project, so he kind of goes where he needs to be. He's been on the case for several, several years, but I think he just left the case and went to a case in New York, which is interesting.
He took a step back, I think it was January 6th.
Right. And they did just get a answer on this cert decision. And basically, the courts threw it back to the lower courts. So they want to see what the lower courts are actually going to do because they feel like they can't step in now at this point because they have been granted the ability to present new information. So they threw it back to the lower court to present that information.
I mean, it's one of those back and forth motions that, you know, the lower court's going to say, well, you know, we did this to the higher court, and the higher court's going to no. And it just gets prolonged, and that's longer time that Rodney really, if he is innocent, has to stay on in prison. So not only is taxpayer money going to pay for him to be in prison, but then when he, if he gets out eventually, he'll be, they have to pay him for his time served. And that's another, just more money that has to be going out. So it really does no justice for him or for the country as a whole. But it's a very public case now. Everybody knows. It's one of those, you know, pardon him. Like, what are you doing?
Well, for me, that's one of the things. Like, this case has really cemented me being against the death penalty. Watching all of this back and forth and then knowing this is a man's life that hangs in the balance of all this. And,
I mean, yeah.
I can't. For cases, I mean, certain cases, yes, I think in certain instances the death penalty should apply. But in cases like this, I can't. That this has been 23 years of this man's life, to know that there's evidence that can prove his innocence or at least give doubt of his guilt.
Yeah, you know, for me, I mean, I'm still pro death penalty, especially like I just watched, you know, I think we've all watched it now. Colleen is probably the last one in on this one, which is the Gabriel Fernandez thing. And let me tell you, I was rooting for death penalty the whole way on that.
Well, that's why I say certain cases, like in that case, in cases like that, we know exactly who did it. Mm-hmm. There's no doubt. There's no question. These two people were pretty much evil in what they did. I believe in cases like that, yeah, I'm all for the death penalty.
Well, I mean, me and you have talked this before. Like, there has to be, I need solid evidence.
Yes.
I need, you know, whether it is, you know, videotaped, whether there's DNA, right. There's got to be some better testimony. It can't just be hearsay. There cannot be any collusion of law enforcement.
It's like a total overhaul. I say this all the time. There's so many of our systems that need a total overhaul, because if you ask those people that were on that jury, they'll tell you that there was solid evidence. They'll tell you that there was no collusion, that they right. saw this man was guilty. They believe mm-hmm. in what, you know, in what they're doing. So
right.
that everything needs to change.
But so do the jurors for Darlie Rudier in the same state. But I mean, then you get a juror that sits there and says, well, I mean, she's obviously guilty. Like, who spends $1,000 on boobs? And I'm like, have you been to California? Like, everyone. Like, you know, I mean, wow. I mean, then I should have been convicted a long time ago, yes.
Well, and that's like we talk about, and like we're going to be talking about it, you know, in a couple weeks or a month or so, about Scott Peterson. Like, there's not death penalty for him. Like, that is
sure,
not enough.
Sure, and that is like okay, so Colleen and I have talked about this repeatedly, of the fact that we just don't see eye to eye on Mr. Peterson. And but what we can agree on is neither of us believe that the death penalty was appropriate in that case. That was an emotional decision for that death penalty, and that had to do, I think it really had to do with the fact that she was pregnant.
Yes.
You know, and I think sure. that was what swayed that jury. You know, and when you watch, if you watch the Netflix, the trials of Gabriel Fernandez, there was one juror who held out both times. First, he wasn't sure that it was first degree murder. And that DA was amazing in the fact that he did give them both options. He did not, like we've talked yes. about in the Casey Anthony case, where she, you know, the lawyer, the DA screwed up in that case by thinking he really had a solid case for a first degree murder and didn't, and then lost the case and can't try her for anything else. So she's walking around free all these years.
Yeah.
You know, but in that case, he gave them the option, and there was one gentleman who held out on that, you know, and he held out both times.
Don't spoil it.
I'm not spoiling it. It doesn't spoil it for you, and you should have caught up by now.
I've been working.
Well, too damn bad, Colleen. I mean, I'm going to need you to stay up to 3 a.m. binging.
It doesn't spoil it. There's just so much, there's so much that you haven't heard. So,
but I mean, it was very important for that one juror, though, to make sure in both things of like, okay, yes, I do believe it was with forethought and, you know, with intention, because that's, you know, there's intention that's how you determine the difference between first and second, intention and forethought, you know, premeditation. Those yeah. are, that's your difference there, right there. And it can be 1 second before, it can be, you know, and we talked about this in the Gypsy case, whether Nick intended or whether he deliberated, you know, and it can be 1 second, 1 second before yes. you decide to take a life, that you make that decision of, I'm going to take this life. You have to make that, and there has to be a clearness of that decision. And in many of these cases, you know, that's not what happens. You're not seeing 100% of that, you know? That is definitely the difference. So he held out first for that, and then they have to go away, and they come back, and they do a sentencing phase, you know, where they have to come back and to put a person to death in California. Now, I'm not sure if that's every single place, but in California, the jury has to unanimously decide on the death penalty. And so the same juror held out in that time too, because it was very grave to him. He had to decide, is there any good in this man? Is there any, or is he only pure evil? Does he deserve to die? And I do applaud him for holding out for that and not just going with everyone else 11-1. Yeah, let's put him away. Let's effing execute him. You know, eventually he decided he was an engineer, and he needed to hear all of the information, and he had to process it, because that's how engineers are taught to think.
Well, and that's how all jurors should be. That's how all court cases in this country should be, you know, not just for small courts like for Rodney Reed, but for the highest courts in this country, including the Senate.
You guys know how I feel. I believe jurors should be professional jurors. I think it shouldn't just be average, regular people. They should have knowledge of the law. There should be, and I don't know how they could do it. I don't know how they'd be able to afford to do it. I don't have that part figured out, but I really think there should be professional jurors that do this for a living.
I mean, I can understand where you're coming from, but then that's a really slippery slope, Christina, because that becomes, so if we need professional jurors to determine these things, then what about voting? Because people are voting and they have no knowledge of the laws, the people they're voting for. They don't know what the hell they're doing. And they just go into a booth and chick, chick, chick.
We've already talked about this.
There needs to be
little education seminar.
Right. But I mean, where do you draw that line and cross over? And I don't know that we're even at this point equipped to even decide that yet. Like, there definitely needs to be an overhaul in all ways. And
yeah, because like you said, someone who says, well, obviously this person is guilty because who the hell goes and gets breast implants? Like, really, right. just the mentality of that has to make you question everything else about the person's mind's frame and how they think of things.
I definitely think there needs to be a better jury selection process. Yes. I don't think that it should just be limited to so many different ways to throw out you can only throw out this many people. And I definitely think that system, the voir dire itself needs to change, much, much more encompassing. Absolutely.
Well, and the education that jurors get, like, here, watch this, mm-hmm. VHS tape about, mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. being a professional juror. People fall asleep through that crap. Mm-hmm. Like nobody's paying attention to that. There needs to be better education to the jurors. You have to be impartial. You are here to do this job. You cannot let your emotions sway you. You have to hear both sides of the evidence.
Right. Right. And you have to be smart enough you really do need to have some sort of education and I don't know if it's necessarily formal education, but you need to have some amount of intelligence to be able to shift through especially in a capital murder case. When we're talking about, okay, it was a robbery and they're going away for, 2 to 5. Okay. I don't think that needs as high of a intelligence of jury pool. But when you're talking a murder case with capital punishment and all of that on the line, oh my God, yes. Because you can't have some really just, person who has absolutely no understanding of the law, no understanding of all kinds of different things, evidence, how it's processed, how it's taken in, how does this work? There is so much that goes into all of this. And if you don't have the intelligence to process all of that, then how on earth can you possibly have a person's life in your hands?
Well, and those trials last for a long time. Mm-hmm. They can go on months. And I think a lot of people will tune out. They'll have already been like, well, I made up my mind and I'm just going to sit and draw doodles for the next, 6 weeks. Mm-hmm. And so that's got to be better stated as well, because you can't do that. Right. And if that's why when, they have like substitute jurors, but the people who are substituting, they would pretty much have to start all freaking over, especially if it's already in the deliberation stage. Mm-hmm. Like, then you have to restart all that stuff.
Well, no, because I mean, they're there the whole time too, even if they're substitute jurors.
But then there's more emotion brought in, like in the Scott Peterson trial, mm-hmm. that last juror, she brought in a hell of a ton of emotion and swayed the rest of them. And that's not okay. You can't be doing that. It's got to still be the same level of professionalism.
Yeah, totally. So tonight we're going to give the early beginnings of this. We're going to explain to you who Stacey was, who Rodney was, how they all got together, what happened in this case, and then, we'll go forward from there. But it's a lot of interesting stuff. I do truly believe this is one of the cases I have looked at over and over and over again now, and I definitely I can't say one way or the other. Like, I'm not, I don't have all the evidence. I haven't seen all the evidence, but an actual evidence, not just proposed evidence. But I absolutely believe that there is a huge, huge case here for reasonable doubt.
Yeah, at the absolute very least, he deserves a new trial.
Absolutely. Definitely.
Don't go anywhere. The Good Wives will be right back.
So you may have realized that our podcast has gone through a couple of changes, and that's because we recently switched our hosting platform over to Buzzsprout, and we love it. We couldn't have had a smoother transition. Buzzsprout made it super simple and gave us amazing features we weren't getting before. If you've been thinking of hosting a podcast or you're looking for a new host platform, then we recommend giving Buzzsprout a try. It is hands down the easiest and best way to launch, promote, and track your podcast. Your show can be online and listed in all the major podcast directories like Apple, Spotify, Google, and so many more within minutes of finishing your recording. Join over 100,000 podcasters already using Buzzsprout to get their message out to the world. And if you follow the link in the show notes, that lets Buzzsprout know we sent you, and it gets you a $20 Amazon gift card if you sign up for a paid plan and help support our show. That's what I call a win-win. In every episode, we like to serve up a special dish from the state that our crime takes place. So here's our resident Cajun Mama Ty to tell you what our true crime dish of the week is.
Cajun Mama Ty here. As you all know, we're on the true crime journey to discover cases and learn the good, the bad, the ugly, and this case is no exception. Today, the girls are talking about a case which takes us to a small town in Texas. Yes, guys, I have a recipe and I have a story.
Calling all night owls. When you've got the after dark munchies, Amigos is here for you to satisfy your late night cravings. Put your hunger to bed with Amigos' new 8 to close specials. Only $5 for two crisp meat burritos, two cheesy burritos, or one of each for those who can't decide. You heard right. Two of our favorite late night sellers, crisp meats or cheesies, for just $5. Head to Amigos, where flavor never sleeps.
The Sonic 2 for 7 deal lets you choose from the Sonic Cheeseburger, Chicken Sandwich, or Footlong Chili Cheese Coney. Any two for $7. So you can mix and match a deliciously melty Sonic Cheeseburger and a crispy chicken sandwich with the perfect amount of pickles. Or you can pair that brioche-topped chicken sandwich with the Footlong Chili Cheese Coney you've been craving. Either way, you'll get two mouthwatering Sonic items for one great price. It might be the greatest pairing since cherry and limeade. Sonic 2 for 7 deal. Tax not included. See menu for details. Limited time only at participating Sonic drive-ins.
One thing you might not know about Cajuns, they very rarely leave their hometowns. If they do, it's for a short time and they always return. But you know, there's always exceptions to the rule, which leads me to my story. I have a very good friend who I've known for 35 plus years. Well, he is what I call a Cajun transplant. He has left home, went to college, and he never came back. Well, at least not yet. Let me explain what a Cajun transplant is. It's when a man or a lady leave, they go away to college, they marry someone from somewhere else, and they move away to another town or to another state, and they never come back home. Well, they become a permanent resident somewhere else. Well, my friend David and his wife Rita met in college here in Louisiana. They moved away. They live in a little town in northern Texas. So when Fancy gave me the okay to do two recipes for Texas, I knew exactly who I was going to call to get some advice. The conversation went a little bit like this. Hey, Keating, That's what I've always called him, because that's his family name. What's up, Ty? Well, you know I'm doing my little podcast thing, and I have a question to ask you. You have a question to ask me? He told me. Yep, I have a question to ask you. What's your favorite thing about living in Texas? My favorite thing about Texas? Has to be barbecue. And you gotta know, in Texas, they barbecue anything and everything. That's what brings me to today's recipe. Texas cowboy barbecue baked beans.
So beginning with Stacey, there's not a lot of information out there about her that I noticed. She was described by her friends as a sweet, outgoing, and kind person. She was a tomboy. She loved sports and being outdoors.
And we spoke with her friend Tammy, and she gave us a statement, and this is what she had to say. My name is Tammy Hanneth. I was good friends with Stacey Stites for many years. She was the sweetest, most caring person I knew. She was funny, beautiful, talented, a hard worker, sincere, and had a huge heart. Her life ended way too soon. I have continued to fight for Rodney Reed. I have never once questioned whether he murdered her or not. Her fiance was insane, irrational, desperate, vile, and very dangerous. And this was before the stay of execution. And she had said that we needed to stand together for Rodney, that he needed to be granted to stay in a new trial, that Texas cannot murder an innocent man. She also talked about Stacey being buried in her wedding dress and that she was very disturbed by the decision that Stacey's mom made in choosing to bury her in the dress. She said her funeral was very odd, very quiet, lots of crazy looks from everyone. I remember seeing Fennel up front with a smirk on his face. I asked why, and they stated he was heavily medicated.
That is super strange.
Right, I was going to say that is so odd.
Who buries their girl in a wedding dress that she never even... Ew.
Yeah, it is. It's disturbing to me also.
And for those of you, if you're not familiar with the case, Fennel is Jimmy Fennel, and that is her fiance, and we will be talking about him later in this episode. But yeah, I mean, so to say that, he's got a smirk on his face because he's heavily medicated. Oh, screw you.
That's
smirking because you got away with it.
Right.
And right. It's one of those things where I think maybe they couldn't get a refund for the wedding dress. So why not bury her in it?
Like, weird. Super strange.
Weird.
But her mother super supports this guy, Jimmy, the weird, crazy fiance. There is no way you can convince her that Jimmy is bad. And even after everything he's done and been convicted of in other cases, she just believes that Stacey and him were meant to be together. And she does not believe that Rodney even knew Stacey, which it's evident that Rodney knew Stacey. And it's just... it's kind of crazy. They met in October of 95, and they both said that, they said that they met at the Diamond Shamrock Pool Hall. She was at the jukebox, and she caught his eye, and they started talking, and it grew into something more. So she even met him before she was engaged, and then she went ahead and still got engaged. So I don't know. This is a small town in Texas back in the 90s. And I can honestly say it's come further, but it still is a very, you stay with your own kind, no interracial marriages, relationships are not looked kindly upon down in that area.
Yeah, it makes sense. I mean, I feel like that's really still evident everywhere, but I feel like it's a little bit more prevalent in the South.
Mm-hmm. Texas especially.
Yes.
Texas especially. There are certain states where, even in the South, like here, I know lots of people who are in interracial marriages, and it does not seem to be as bad as, say, Texas or Alabama.
I was going to say Alabama.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. There's, it's just... we'd like to all sit in, you know, our perfect homes and think that racism doesn't exist, but it does.
Well, and it's not even saying that it's just, you know, white people saying that white and black people can't be together. There's mm-hmm. a lot of it from the other side as well.
As well.
Mm-hmm. It's, yes. You know, why are you dating a white guy? Stay with your own, you know, with your mm-hmm. own. And it comes from both sides. So we're not saying that one side is worse than the other.
Right.
Just for people listening.
A lot of times it's that small town mentality.
Yeah.
Yep. Yeah. And so Stacey met and began dating Jimmy while she was with Rodney. And around New Year's Eve of 1996, they get engaged and she moves in with him in Giddings. And they live right above her mother. And her friends, they basically all say that she changed. And we've got a clip from Tammy from an interview she did, I believe, for the Dr. Phil show is the one that we're doing. So.
I know that whenever she had told me that, you know, she had started dating Jimmy and, you know, that she was happy because she thought that she actually found somebody that she could spend the rest of her life with, and that things, you know, you have to work to make things work in the relationship. And at first it seemed like everything was coming together. And then there are a few times, I guess, after she had moved to Giddings, I talked to her maybe once a week. Then it went to like once every 2 weeks, and then it kind of got, you know, far-fetched. And I know multiple times that she was supposed to come down, or, you know, she wanted to go out and he didn't want that. You know, she was supposed to be at home, you know, cooking supper, doing, you know, already kind of like the wife thing that she shouldn't. Why would she want to go out anymore? You know, so I think when their relationship started, we got more distant. Multiple times he would walk in and hang up the phone before even saying anything. I know one time, I don't know if it was during Jamboree, it was kind of like a big fair that they had. She wanted to come down to it, and he was like, there's no way in hell. The next day, tires are slashed in her truck.
So, you know, a lot of her friends described her as engaged but not happy. Okay, so Stacey told one of her coworkers about being engaged, and the coworker was like, oh, that's wonderful. You're probably so excited. And she gave like a very strange look, and the coworker said that she then asked her, well, what's going on? And she's like, oh, well, yeah, I'm engaged, but I'm sleeping with this black guy. And, you know, I really like him. And I'm just so concerned about what Jimmy will do, you know, if he finds out. And the girl was like, oh my God, Stacey, you can't do that. Like, I'm very fearful for you. You're dating a black guy, and you're dating a white cop. Like, that's very dangerous for everyone.
Right. That is, you know, asking almost to get a little bit in trouble in these kind of small towns.
Mm-hmm.
And to really kind of be flaunt in it to just, I mean, a coworker. I mean, I don't really know how close they were, but they're like, yeah, I'm engaged, but I'm sleeping with this guy on the side.
Yeah. Like
that's.
Said that any time that Jimmy came into the store, that Stacey would be terrified. And they said that Jimmy was very controlling. So, I mean, if she was able to confide in that one person, I'm sure she was paying attention whenever Jimmy would come in the store. And for her to be terrified anytime he came in the store, like just that alone.
It shows how, you know, their relationship dynamic kind of worked.
Yeah,
it did. And it took that young lady, Alicia, 19 years to come forward with that information. And she, you know, she didn't want to come forward because she was scared because of everything that had happened, especially after what she knew Jimmy to be convicted of and things that he had done and all the other police that worked on the force with him at the time and what they were doing and what she knew to be things that they were, you know, putting that they were doing was wrong in the case in other ways. You know, they were very, it was a very corrupt town, and it was well known.
Yeah, I can imagine how scary it would be to know something in this case and be hesitant to come forward.
And being a whistleblower is difficult.
She had even shared with this coworker, Stacey had shared with her, that Jimmy had told her, he did say to her definitely 100% that if he found out, he would kill her and he would make it look like the guy did it, you know, and that he would get away with it because he was a cop. And that's exactly what I believe happened.
Stacey and I worked at a grocery store in Bastrop, Texas. Stacey and I hung out at work only. We talked about girl things, boyfriends. Stacey told me that she was engaged to a police officer in Giddings. It was one of the days at lunch, and I asked her about her engagement ring and if she was really excited to get married. And she then proceeded to tell me that she wasn't that excited because she was sleeping with a black guy named Rodney. I was, you know, wow, Stacey, you need to be careful. In the 90s, Bastrop, Texas did not have many interracial couples. It was kind of an underlining racism that no one really talked about because that's just how it was back then. Stacey did say that she was worried about Jimmy and what he would do if he ever found out she was cheating on him. So she had told me that she was sleeping with Rodney, and it was about a month later that she was murdered. When I found out Stacey had died, my first thought was, did she get caught cheating?
But, you know, what I thought was really amazing, and we're going to put a clip of this so you guys can hear it yourselves, but it was Rodney's reaction to her coming forward. You know, he's spent 23 plus years on death row, never knowing whether he was going to, you know, live past whatever, and if he was ever going to get home to his family, his children, his mother, his brothers, you know, and if that were me, I don't know that I would handle it as graciously as this family, as Rodney has handled it. And when he found out that she came forward, he thanked her. And Dr. Phil asked him how he felt about that. And he said, well, I can understand, because when he was first questioned, he lied and said that he didn't know Stacey. And that actually came back to bite him later. You know, but he said, I didn't want to be involved in this case. I can't imagine what somebody on the outside, you know, of this case would want, because, and he just thanked her for coming forward now and was kind, and he understood. And I, like I said, I'm not quite sure that I would have.
Yeah. He had very humble and graceful reaction to that. Mm-hmm. I don't know if I would be the same in the situation.
Did your people know you were having a relationship with her?
Yes, there were people that knew, but there were people in my circle, you know, friends and family members of mine.
Do you know Alicia Slater?
No, I don't.
She says that she knew Stacey for a year. She said Stacey said that she knew you, and that she spoke very highly of you. She said she didn't tell the police about your relationship with Stacey because she didn't want to get involved and now feels guilty about it. How do you feel about the fact that she's let you sit here for 19 years without ever bringing this out?
I look at it this way. It kind of goes back to when I was asked, did I know Stacey? And the first thing because I didn't want to get involved and I didn't want to be part of an investigation. And I can see where she didn't want to be a part of an investigation. I can say that I do appreciate that she, you know, took the initiative to step forward, say something. I don't even know her.
And the composure that his family shows is unreal. Like, they just have, their faith is strong, let me tell you. That family is strong with faith.
Well, I think you need to get through what this family has been through. And I think a lot of people do turn to a religion or to some sort of belief to get through tough times. And it's a good thing they did, because I know many, many families, I think including myself, that if there was to be something like this, would not be handling it as well as Rodney has, but also the family. And there'd be a lot of screaming, a lot of anger. More saltiness.
Yeah, definitely.
Don't go anywhere. The Good Wives will be right back.
What if you could be a true crime detective right from the comfort of your own home? Dispatch is an interactive serial mystery that unfolds over several months. Imagine the experience of an escape room in your own home, a new kind of escape called Dispatch. It's a subscription box that's a step apart from everyday entertainment. Better than a book, more engaging than television, think of it as an immersive mystery where you wear the detective hat. The story begins with your first delivery, or dispatch, if you will. In it, you'll find physical clues that lead you to the web and back to the real world to unravel a mysterious crime. Grab a friend, the whole family, and your thinking cap, and get ready to put your heads together for one mind-bending ride as additional details are revealed with every package. Head over to our Instagram at www.instagram.com/truecrimewives and click on the link in our bio, then choose the dispatch button to start your own true crime adventure today.
This recipe is easy and calls for a slow cooker. I love recipes like this, where you can throw everything into a pot and leave it in for hours. Then come home, bam, supper is ready in minutes. The first step you will need to do is brown your ground beef until there is no pink at all. Once the meat is brown, drain off the fat, set the meat aside. I personally would use some of that fat from the brown ground beef to brown my onions instead of throwing a raw onion into a slow cooker. But you know, that's me, and I probably would use the Cajun Trinity, onion, celery, and bell pepper instead of just using an onion. Now comes the fun part. Make sure you have at least a 3.5-quart slow cooker. Combine ground beef, baked beans, green chilies, onions, or your Cajun Trinity, and the barbecue sauce. My preference is Sweet Baby Ray's. Then you add your seasonings, brown sugar, garlic powder, chili powder, and of course, a few dashes of your Louisiana hot sauce. Put your cover on, cook it on high for 2 hours, or on low for 4 hours. I guarantee you will smell your entire house of barbecue. When you get home from work, light the pit, grill a couple of steaks. Guaranteed. Delicious. My grandma always told me the best way to get to the people you love is to feed them a good meal.
Another great recipe. For the full recipe that was shared tonight, join us at our exclusive membership club at www.patreon.com/truecrimewives.
So we've already talked a little bit about Stacey and a tiny bit about Rodney, but I think for you guys to understand the story, we're going to have to talk about Jimmy. And Jimmy Fennell was a police officer, and he was a police officer who was used to getting his way, and a police officer that really felt that he himself was kind of above the law. And we've already kind of talked about the fact that he has made threats about killing if she cheated on him. And he said right in front of their insurance agent that he would kill her and nobody would know it was him.
Calling all night owls. When you've got the after dark munchies, Amigos is here for you to satisfy your late night cravings. Put your hunger to bed with Amigos' new 8 to close specials. Only $5 for 2 crisp meat burritos, 2 cheesy burritos, or one of each, for those who can't decide. You heard right, 2 of our favorite late night sellers, crisp meats or cheesies, for just $5. Head to Amigos, where flavor never sleeps.
When you download the Baker's app, you have easy access to savings every day. Get the most out of weekly sales and receive personalized coupons to save on your favorite items, all while earning one fuel point for every dollar spent. Baker's makes it easy to save while you shop, whether it's in-store or online, so you get the most value out of every trip, every time. Download the Baker's app now to save big on your next purchase. Baker's, fresh for everyone. Must have a digital account to redeem offers. Restrictions may apply. See site for details.
And then he went on to tell his fellow officer, a woman fellow officer that came forward, that he would strangle her if she cheated. And the cop said, well, they'd get DNA. And he said, no, I'll do it with a belt.
That's so messed up to be telling, you know, in front of your insurance agent, but to tell another cop, yep.
So arrogant and so brazen. It's disgusting.
Right. Nobody is above the law, especially not in a small town like that.
And well, Jimmy really thought he was above the law. Really.
And there was a prosecutor from Giddings who really did think Jimmy was guilty, but he couldn't do anything because it wasn't his case. It wasn't his department. It wasn't his county, because where she was found and where they say she was murdered was not Giddings. So he didn't have anything. He even tried to call and speak to the DA, and the DA basically told him, I don't need your help. Thanks a lot. And so we've got a sound clip of that prosecutor giving his thoughts.
Let me just say this, and I mean, you know, again, this is my personal opinion, but my personal opinion when I heard that she had been killed was that Fennell had done it immediately. And I know a number of people around here that felt the same way, because they'd either observed enough about his personality and that sort of thing. And when we heard that she had been having an affair with a black guy, it was like, well, that's why he did it, you know, because his ego wouldn't let him. I mean, that would be a tremendous affront to his ego, you know, his bride-to-be, you know, messing around with a black guy, you know, he couldn't handle it.
I think was really interesting was, you know, they always say whenever you're watching a true crime show or you're whatever, the very first thing that you hear from someone is, well, they were arguing the night before, and they use that always, you know, that's always a thing that comes up. We were having an argument, you know, did you love your wife, do whatever, all those different things. And they use those things against them to prove, you know, that there was something wrong in paradise, and it's not what the guy is generally telling. And in this case is no different. They actually had an argument in public that actual day. And the gentleman that was there that witnessed it and came forward even said he heard him tell her he was going to kill her.
I had a client tell me that she had seen Stacey Stites and her fiance the morning that Stacey had apparently disappeared outside of a convenience store bar by the name of the Old Frontier in Page. I have known Charles Pennick, who was the criminal district attorney until recently. And so I approached him and told him that I had a client who might have witnessed something that was pertinent to the Stacey Stites disappearance, murder, and that I would be glad to furnish that information to him. And his response to me was, I have all the evidence on that case that I want or need, and I don't want to hear any more about that case. And basically, I left it at that. Even when she told me this story, that she didn't know that that would necessarily be inconsistent with what everybody said had happened. In other words, she did not know what the fiancé's story was about. I mean, for all she knew, he could have said we were at Page and we were talking and whatever. I went back home. But I understand that that's not the story that he told or the statements that he gave.
I mean, it's just insane that there's eyewitness, you know, and no, it's fine. It doesn't matter. And honestly, like, the husband is always the one who did it. We all know.
And I mean, I just ordered a shirt that says the husband did it.
Right. Like, I'm pretty sure that's on my wish list is a notebook that says that.
Yeah. The husband did it.
And if it's not the husband, it's almost always a family member or neighbor or somebody close.
Right. This reminds me a lot of the Adam Walsh case, where the police and the DA all kind of ignored the evidence that the police were not finding, you know, like that they were trying more to prove that Otis didn't kill Adam than they ever did to prove that he did, you know? And that's what this reminds me of. Well, at trial, Jimmy testifies that he'd never met Rodney, but he actually had approached him 2 weeks before Stacy's murder. And he threatened him and said that he knew about him and Stacy, and he was going to make him pay. So, you know, at trial, Jimmy testifies he never meets Rodney Reed, but he had actually approached him 2 weeks before Stacy's murder, and he threatened Rodney that he knew about him and Stacy, and he was going to make him pay. And there was a witness to that.
Curtis Davis. Davis is
passenger in the car when this happens. He's a fellow officer. You're going to hear that over and over again. And on the 22nd, when this was supposed to have gone down, Davis leaves 1 hour into his shift, claiming he has a broken tooth.
Now, between the years of 95 and 98, there are 5 counts of police brutality filed against Stacy's fiance. And in one of those, a 19-year-old man named Mario Murillo is handcuffed, forced to his knees, and Jimmy holds a service revolver to his head. Now, if this doesn't scream, I have the power and nobody else does, I don't know what is.
Right. You know, my dad is a police officer, and he used to tell me that there were only 2 types of police. You know, there's the police officer that started because he wants to make a difference, and they're generally the ones that get very cynical in old age, you know. And then there's the ones who do it because they think it's some power trip. It's like a short man's disease, or, you know, they think that they can wield a gun and be powerful. A lot of times they're the overweight cop, you know, that maybe he grew up as a, overweight kid and then got real buff in his, like, you know, early 20s and got involved in being a cop and really is that type of guy that thinks that, you know, being a cop is power instead of the fact that they are there to protect and serve.
It's almost like an overcompensation for something that they feel or know that they're lacking.
And if you look at the pictures of Jimmy that we're going to put in Patreon, I mean, you can find them online too, obviously, but we put a lot of stuff in our Patreon account from these things. And if you look at him, I mean, he is classically that first, you know, that first one, or the, I mean, the latter that is that cop that thinks it's about power.
And in October of 2007, so later on, Jimmy rapes a woman who he was called out to a domestic violence call, which you should not rape anybody. You really can't. But to do it as a police officer during your shift when you're called to help somebody. And his fellow officers are there for this too, and they take her husband away in one cop car, and Jimmy is left with her. He traps her in the back of the car, says he's going to take her down to the station, and instead drives to a remote area, assaults her, holds a gun to her head, and tells her if she tells anyone, he will get out of prison and kill her.
Yeah.
Just that power trip. But
beyond power trip.
I cannot get over you're in the line of duty. You are wearing your uniform. Mm-hmm. You're wearing your badge to protect and serve your community, and you are supposed to go out to help a woman for domestic violence, and you're going to be the one to assault her.
And she finally came forward, you know, and he got arrested and put in prison for all of that. But, you know, to hear her tell it, and we're going to play those clips for you here in a second. I mean, the fear even now in her voice when she speaks about this is insane, and you know, and it's real and it's raw. And he did just recently get out, and she is standing up. Like, you know, if I were her, I don't know if I would be out speaking out against him at this point. He's out, you know, and she is. And I think that's very brave. And I truly, truly believe that Connie deserves a medal of honor in standing up and making sure that he, you know, that she still continues to talk about what happened to her.
I was leaned up against my face down. He had was holding my face down with one of his hands. And he took his gun out and he placed it against my head. And he raped me. He had sexual intercourse with me. After he was done, he put me back into the patrol car and told me that if I ever told anybody that when he got out of prison, he would hunt me down and he would kill me.
He just kept telling me to shut up. He asked me to dance for him. And I told him no. And when I told him no, he got mad. And he grabbed me and slammed me up against the back of his car where the trunk is. I kept telling him to stop, but he just told me to shut up, that I knew I liked it. And then if I told anybody, that he'd hunt me down when he got out of prison and kill me.
Yeah, I think it's clear as a police officer and as a man, Jimmy Fennell is a shitty person all around the board. I mean, just every account we've heard of him from everybody is he was controlling. He was angry, he was threatening, he was aggressive, and it jumped from police brutality to rape.
Right. And I mean, he had her in handcuffs. He handcuffed her and he raped her on the hood of his police car. Like, he's called out there to protect her from her husband, who is, you know, supposedly assaulting her. And what happens? The person that comes out to help you and to protect you, you know, you're telling her, well, I'm going to take you in this other car and you're, you know, we're going to run you both in and everything. And then this is what he does. And then he drives her back to where he, you know, he picked her up and drops her off and is like, okay, now if you say anything, I'm going to totally come out of prison and kill you.
I don't understand how anybody doesn't see Jimmy Fennell as the prime suspect in Stacey's murder. I just don't understand. It makes no sense to me other than it being erasing. What else? It's a person close to you and ends up being convicted of rape. Why is it so hard for people to believe that he should be suspect number one in this murder?
Well, I think it really has a lot to do with him being law enforcement too.
So. Well, that also, that I know is a huge part.
And well, he had help. I mean, there's no way that he did all this by himself. He had help and he got help from his brothers in blue. And that is sad.
And there's collusion.
Sad. Yeah. Yeah.
Don't go anywhere. The Good Wives will be right back.
So you often hear NCS Good Wives sipping a glass of wine. And one of our favorite wine clubs is California Wine Club. And we've got a special offer for you. If you click our link in the description below before March 31st, 2020, then you can save half off your first month when you join at any club level. California Wine Club only works with small wineries and they hand select 2 bottles of wine each month and ship them straight to your door. Now you don't even have to go to the liquor store to have a sip of bubbly with us. How cool is that? We absolutely love hearing from our listeners, and we'd like to invite you to send us a question for us to answer or a case you'd like us to cover. You can drop us an email at goodwivesdish, that's D-I-S-H, @gmail.com, and we might play it live in one of our next episodes. We look forward to hearing from you.
So we're going to talk about the murder of Stacey and some of the discrepancies that have happened. So her time of death is one of the discrepancies. The original time of death was ruled at 3:45. This was based on the last time Stacey was supposed to be seen. This was 3:45 a.m. and what time she did not arrive at work. Scientifically and medically, this turns out to be wildly inaccurate.
And Jimmy, you know, his alibi wavers in this too. Originally, He said he was with Stacey all night. They had dinner with her mother, and they went upstairs, and she says, you know, she corroborates that they were laughing and joking on their way up, and they were talking about the wedding and everything was good. And then later on, Jimmy actually begins to tell people, other officers and people that do eventually, you know, start to talk, that he was out all night and that he was at the bar. And so which one is it? You know, the actual cause of death, is different too, but, let's hear the accounting from Bryce about, you know, the details that Jimmy gave.
What he's saying is that Rodney Reed's guilt, the state's theory of how this crime occurred, is medically and scientifically impossible. And the time of death is actually when Jimmy Fennell said that he was alone with Stacey Stites in their apartment. And this was significant because at that hearing, we also heard from Jimmy Fennell's best friend at the time, who was a Bastrop sheriff's officer, who Jimmy Fennell actually gave a different story about where he was during this critical time period of when Stacey was murdered. He claimed that he had actually gone out late that night and was drinking, and that he came home late at night, and that Stacey left in the morning without him. And so what we have here is a completely different forensic picture that shows the time of death is at a time that Jimmy Fennell told the jury he was at home with Stacey Stites and now does not even have a consistent story about. When we asked Jimmy Fennell about this at the hearing, he refused to testify and asserted his Fifth Amendment privilege not to incriminate himself.
The cause of death is ruled as strangulation, but this is not correct either based on facts. They ruled it this way based just on the ligature markings around her neck, but no classic signs of strangulation were evident. In fact, there is an investigator who describes the ligature marks and how they cannot possibly be consistent with what they rule this.
We thought we had the crime scene tape, but apparently there's a lot of the tape that wasn't provided to us that it shows where there could have been cross-contamination, because anal sex became a big issue with the jury. Big issue. And but it shows where cross-contamination could have taken place during that forensic investigation, because of not changing gloves when touching other parts of the body at the time.
The key on your ligature is, if you look at the ligature in these pictures, it's the wrong color. If she had died from ligature strangulation, it should be a pink mark. Now, if the ligature had been found on her, there would have been a different story, because, if, you know, her heart would have stopped beating, and then you would have started maybe seeing this. But this tells you she's dead. She'd been long dead when this ligature was placed on her neck. I confronted Bayardo about that in June Dune. I said, when you look at the ligature, tell it's real postmortem. I said, it's clear she died of suffocation. You know, Bardo popped back at me. Well, strangulation, suffocation too. I laughed. I said, not the same. It's not what we're talking about. I'm not talking about that type. We're talking about compression, suffocation. He says, well, Dave, you're right. He says, it's very difficult, as you know, to tell the difference between strangulation and suffocation. You know what he said then? So I just guessed. A man's on death row. He says he just guessed.
Stacey was reported missing around 8 a.m., but her body was found by a passerby at 3 p.m. And the crime scene was super clean and looked extremely staged. There were no footprints, her body looked like it had just been placed there, and it was very obvious that she had not been killed there, more like a dump site.
But they try to say that that's where she was killed. But, I mean, there's been some investigators that Dr. Phil had on that break down this scene. And, I mean, they go into extreme detail as to how all of this could not possibly have gone down the way that it was described originally. It is scientifically and medically impossible. And let's hear from those investigators that broke down the scene.
we know through the physical forensic evidence that the murder actually took place well before midnight in this apartment.
When you look at the autopsy report and look at the injuries, most of them are on the left side. So everything looks like the attack came from the left. When you walk in the bathroom and you look at the tub, the faucet and everything are on the left.
She was wet. Her jeans were still wet. So I'm thinking she's close. She maybe she put the water on and he came in with the belt behind her and he pushed it down like this. And that's where she might get some of the burning.
When we look at the injuries that she has, the bruising on her head, second degree and third degree burn injuries, everything's predominantly on the left side that's pre-death.
And the lividity was all in the front part of her body.
The body was found. There was a lot of lividity from here up, right? So I think he left over the top like this. See the hands? They were white at the tips, which means the fingers had contact marks, which means her fingers had to be somewhere like this, down, right? Where all the blood settled, but they didn't settle on the tips.
The amazing thing is usually when you're strangled, especially a manual strangulation, her hyoid bone should have been ruptured. Her larynx should have had some kind of damage. But the first thing that should have occurred when somebody's strangling somebody is the petechia in the eyes, the little blood vessels, should burst. She doesn't even have that. Yet she has petechia on the top of the head. So you can see that there's punching down. He's pushing her down into where the spigot was. She absorbed almost like 16 ounces of fluid in her lungs. So as far as I'm concerned, that was a drowning.
Calling all night owls. When you've got the after dark munchies, Amigos is here for you to satisfy your late night cravings. Put your hunger to bed with Amigos new 8 to close specials. Only $5 for two crisp meat burritos, two cheesy burritos, or one of each for those who can't decide. You heard right. Two of our favorite late night sellers, crisp meats or cheesies for just $5. Head to Amigos, where flavor never sleeps.
Hello and welcome to The Baker's Show. At Baker's, everyone wins when it comes to saving big. Because when you order online through the Baker's app, you get the same great prices, deals, and rewards on pickup or delivery that you do in-store with no hidden fees or markups. So no matter how you shop, you'll always save big at Baker's. Baker's, fresh for everyone.
Save big on your favorites with the Buy 5 or More Save a Dollar Each sale. Simply buy 5 or more participating items and save a dollar each with your card. Baker's, fresh for everyone.
So, and in this, you know, they're saying that she was strangled, but there was water in her lungs. So you can't be strangled and have water in your lungs at the same time. They suspect that it was a combination between a strangulation and drowning. And basically they think what happened is that it happened in her own apartment. In her own bathroom, and that she was basically leaning over the tub when she was approached from behind, and he threw the belt around her neck like he said he was going to do, and he then pushed her forward into what, you know, into the water that she was running and murdered her well before 3:45 a.m. They believe it happened before midnight.
Right. I was just going to say that is exactly what I'm picturing in my head. I've seen it before in another case where it was a husband murdered his prior wife like that, and then he murders his second wife just like that as well. And he was in law enforcement as well, believe it or not. But,
well, I mean, that's the thing. Jimmy would know exactly how to get away with murder.
Right, but the fact that, you know, they're saying, yep, it is strangulation 100% just because there is marks around her neck. But when a medical examiner says, like, no, there's water in her lungs, you do not get water in your lungs from, like, choking while you're being choked. That's not, right. You don't have that kind of water in your lungs. Like, no, you're not aspirating saliva. Well,
and they never, and see, this is where the investigators screwed up. They never searched the apartment. So they potentially left tons and tons and tons of evidence unfounded. And even in a case where she's killed somewhere else, I've never heard of them not searching her apartment to determine motives and different, all kinds of different things come from searching the apartment. It's not just looking for, you know, whatever and believing that she was killed there. There's all kinds of stuff that could have been found in her home.
All kinds of evidence that saying that, you know, he did it, Jimmy did it, but saying like, oh, well, you know, maybe she left a bowl of cereal out or you know, there, her phone was there, or she left a sticky note that says, yep, I'm meeting with Rodney. Like, there's right. so much more evidence that can be in somebody's apartment, not just a murder mm-hmm. scene.
Yeah, there's a number of different things that they could have looked for or found. And I guess because Jimmy was a cop, you know, no need to search the house.
Right. No need to search the house. There's nothing there. And you know, her mother says that she heard her walk down the stairs and leave. Like, and we're going to get into that more in the trial in the next episode. But that's one of the things that boggled my mind. Like, did you see her walk down the stairs, ma'am? No, I just heard her walk down the stairs. And that was at the time that she was supposed to go to work. And I never heard her go back up the stairs. But you did hear Jimmy come in later. Yes, you heard somebody come in later when he was coming up and down the stairs and telling you that she was, you know, not that they didn't, she never arrived at work and all those things. Oh, yeah. Well, then how did you know that it was her? How do you know it's not Jimmy dragging her body down the stairs at 3:45 a.m.? You have no idea. What happened? Were you watching at 3:45 a.m.? Were you at the window watching your daughter walk down? No, you weren't. So you can't tell me beyond a shadow of a doubt that you know that that was her just because that's the time that she normally gets up. He knows that. Duh.
Well, Ray, you can be at 3:45. Most people sleeping, sound asleep. Like, right. Where did you really hear it? Was it just a dream? Was it somebody just walking around outside?
Well, I know in an apartment complex, yes, I can believe that she heard it because I lived in apartments for a very long time and it didn't matter day, night, middle of the night, 4 o'clock in the morning. I heard the people above me every single time they made noise and it would pull me out of a dead sleep. You know, I mean,
yeah, I live in an apartment now. So yeah,
my first apartment, my upstairs neighbor, I worked double shifts at a nursing home, mm-hmm. and as soon as I got home, like I had homework to do, I was tired. But right. every single night, my upstairs neighbor would walk around in high heels vacuuming mm-hmm. at like 1 a.m. I'm like, what the hell is wrong with you? Please stop.
So, you know, she is found. So basically the story goes that she leaves every morning at the specific time, you know, to head to work at IGA. And somewhere along the route that she is traveling, Rodney somehow, never meeting her before, gets his way into her car. And he basically then rapes her, accosts her, and then he kills her. Like, this is what is supposed to have happened. And then he takes her body and she's found not on the course that she was on. She's found in an isolated road. And this is not a road that she would have been traveling down. It's off the way. And it's not necessarily where he would have taken her. It's very odd. It's an extremely odd situation of where she is found. And like we said before, for where it was being this isolated road, it was too freaking clean. Like, just way, way too clean. And then her, you know, Jimmy's truck is abandoned in the high school parking lot. And then where it's like, how would he have gotten back from that had he not had an accomplice to come and pick him up? You know, and she's found, she's half naked and she is still wet. And there is no wet around her that would have made her wet like that.
And when we say wet, we don't mean like, you know, she washed her hair in the shower and it was still a little bit damp from washing her hair. No, mm-hmm. She was wet.
Yeah. As if she had just been placed there. Her jeans were still wet. You know, obviously this stinks. It stinks. And, you know, Dr. Phil had several forensic pathologists look at this, the different investigators that have been looking into this case for many, many years. And the pathologist that we're going to play here for you, I mean, he basically claims that this is one of the biggest travesties of justice he's ever seen. Because the facts of the case just don't add up with the story that's being told.
Well, Dr. Sarah Wecht is a renowned forensic pathologist who has investigated many famous cases, including President John F. Kennedy, Elvis Presley, JonBenet Ramsey. And he's joining us on satellite now to tell us what he discovered after looking at Stacey's autopsy report. In your opinion, do you believe that Stacey was murdered before midnight?
Yes, Dr. Phil. There is simply no question from a forensic scientific standpoint that Stacey Stites was murdered before midnight. I would say without hesitation that this is one of the clearest, unequivocal cases of gross, gross misjudgment, of travesty of justice that I've ever seen. You can argue about a lot of cases, and Dr. Phil, you and I have talked about some of these. This case, there simply is no argument.
Well, let me tell you one thing additionally. This medical expert at the time, Dr. Roberto Bayardo, on August 13th of 2012, said time of death, if the prosecuting attorneys had advised me they intended to use my time of death estimate as a scientifically reliable opinion, I would have advised them not to do so. He went on to say, survival of sperm, the spermatozoa I found in Ms. Stites could have been deposited days before her death. And with regard to sexual assault, there is no indication that the spermatozoa was placed there in any fashion other than consensually. If their own witness says, you misinterpreted what I said, you misused what I said, I now tell you that that is wrong, it seems to me they have to own that problem and step back from that conviction.
Thank you. Absolutely. There's no way in the world that this can proceed.
And I appreciate your input, Doctor. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Doctor. Thank you.
Don't go anywhere. The Good Wives will be right back.
Every great podcast needs a great website. Currently, our mother company, Mad Ginger Entertainment, is building their website using Bluehost. Bluehost is one of the best and most affordable web hosting platforms available. Plans start as low as $2.95 a month, and you can even integrate it with WordPress. So if you need your own website or affordable web hosting, grab our discount link in the description and get your podcast a bigger presence online at low, low costs.
This is one of those situations where, you know, I truly believe that that is when you have to have a jury that is informed, that can understand X, Y, and Z does not go with A, B, and C.
What, like the fact that, you know, the crime scene doesn't add up, her method of being murdered doesn't line up. There's too many questionable aspects of this case to say, yep, this guy did it and he deserves the death penalty.
Oh my God.
Without,
yeah.
No. There's too, it's not within, you know, a shadow of a doubt. Yes. Not even close.
To
the shadow of a doubt.
I mean, if this was any other man, if Jimmy Finnell was a plumber, a teacher, an electrician, it wouldn't have went this way.
No.
I mean, he would have been suspect number one. They would have searched the apartment.
Yep.
Nothing would have went the way it went. And I think it would have been a completely different outcome.
Yes. Totally different. But the thing is that the Innocence Project has worked so hard so many times to bring forward new things and different things, and they have just not been heard over and over and over and over again. And it is sad because, I mean, this is truly one of those cases that you go, wow, if OJ can get off on, if the glove doesn't fit, you must acquit, like, this is absolutely, the glove isn't even a glove. It's a mitten. Like, you know, it doesn't fit. None of this fits. And they try to say, well, she didn't know Rodney. Well, lots of people knew that she knew Rodney. Lots of people, and not just her, his family, or, you know, because a lot of his family knew, but not just his family, people that knew her, people that are in her family, people in her family believe that Rodney is completely innocent and stand up and say that over and over and over again. And there's been many, many, many arguments within this family based on the fact that certain people in the family believe one way and others in the family believe another way. And it, to me, I just think that the people that are believing one way, they're burying their heads in the sand and they just don't want it to be that way. And maybe it's because of their own prejudice against their daughter being with a black man.
Yeah, I think that plays a really big part. It's almost like being in denial. Like if we don't admit it's true, then it didn't happen.
Oh my goodness. So we've given you a lot to think about tonight in this case. Hold on, because next week it gets a whole lot wilder and crazier. As we begin to look into the investigation, some of the other officers involved, we're going to look at the trial, which is a sham. And it just, from tampering with evidence to other officers directly involved with her murder and the cover-up, I mean, this story has it all, man. And through it all, the family remains so, so, so gracious and composed.
I mean, it just says a lot about the family and how, on both sides, I wish that Stacey's mom would rise the hell up, but we'll get into that next episode.
Yeah.
And it will be quite a interesting ride, and we get to talk a little bit more about some of the updates that have happened. A lot has happened in the last few months, and everything is going to be continuing to evolve.
Right. And Rodney can still use your help, you know. I mean, it's not ending just because the public got a stay of execution and got him into the new trial. We need to be lobbying for them to hear all the evidence, for them to do all this. You know, we still need to support them. And they send, the family sends weekly updates to him from his supporters who follow them on Facebook. They've got a couple pages and we'll link to those in our show notes. So you can go on if you want to support Rodney. You can find out about the petitions that they have. There's all kinds of different stuff. You can also go on to the Innocence Project website and look up Rodney Reed. And there's a lot of information on there as well. But this is the story just gets nuttier and nuttier with the amount of just blatant corruption. This is one of those cases that makes me hate law enforcement, you know, and I am a big law enforcement supporter. I believe in our boys in blue. I always support them. I have many family members and friends and that are involved in law enforcement. And I myself wanted to go into law enforcement at one point in time. And I'm actually going back to school right now to do, you know, private investigations and things like that. So I truly believe in the law and enforcing it and in supporting our police forces and our first responders, our firemen. But this case, it's sad because it's one, you know, one blemish on such a, you know, great amount of people. But this case is just, it's sad and it is very infuriating.
Yeah, you hear about that blue wall of silence, and this plays a huge part because more people know the truth. He had to have help.
Yeah.
So if there were a few good people that would join together and come together and speak out, I think it would have been it would have been helpful. I mean, I know a few people have stood up and said what they know and what Jimmy Fennell said to them and things like that. So there are people trying to help, but there has to be more than one officer, one of his fellow officers that knew what happened.
Well, I mean, there's about, I think it's five or six that are directly involved in this. And it is a group of them that have been doing this for years together of covering each other's tracks. But it also kind of like, you know, in a couple cases that we're following right now, the Lori Vallow case, where it's like people are just turning up dead left and right on that woman's watch. Like literally, man, this is the same way here. Like anyone who begins to say something in this case or begins to be investigated that would have put Jimmy as being prime suspect again and doing anything that would have, you know, helped free Rodney, they end up dead. There is many, and then the family members of those guys have begun to speak out and say that they believe that their, you know, their family members knew something and they didn't realize, you know, the ramifications. And once they started getting deeper and deeper and deeper, they decided they were going to come forward, or they had been pressured, you know, to come forward by somebody else. And then they were gone. So it is a super, super, very layered, I can say. This was levels of corruption, not just one person, not just a single policeman that was able to cover his own tracks or whatever because he was smart. No, this was several small town police officers who got together and basically just decided to railroad this guy, in my opinion, you know, from what I've seen. You know, and these people, the other people that sit there and say, have you read the transcripts? Have you did it? And I'm like, yeah, I have. But have you heard these other things? Do you hear what is going on? Like, he's been convicted of this, and this one did that, and this one was convicted in another case of tampering with evidence, but you're going to say that he didn't tamper with evidence in this case? Are you serious?
Oh, yeah, the denial in this one is strong.
Strong.
Thanks so much for tuning in and dishing true crime with the Good Wives.
Don't forget to join our Patreon member club to get the full recipe shared tonight, inside documents and pictures from the case, bonus mini podcast episodes, live YouTube discussion, and an exclusive invitation to our discussion group on Facebook, and get some amazing Good Wives merch.
Follow us on Twitter and Instagram at True Crime Wives. And for more inside information, check us out on YouTube at Murder by Design, where we're currently talking about a few different true crime cases, from bullying murders to serial killers. We dish it all.
Have a good one from the Good Wives, serving up true crime, one dish at a time.
Hello and welcome to The Baker's Show. At Baker's, everyone wins when it comes to saving big. Because when you order online through the Baker's app, you get the same great prices, deals, and rewards on pickup or delivery that you do in-store, with no hidden fees or markups. So no matter how you shop, you'll always save big at Baker's. Baker's, fresh for everyone.
Save big on your favorites with the Buy 5 or More Save a Dollar Each sale. Simply buy 5 or more participating items and save a dollar each with your card. Baker's, fresh for everyone.
When you download the Baker's app, you have easy access to savings every day. Get the most out of weekly sales and receive personalized coupons to save on your favorite items, all while earning one fuel point for every dollar spent. Baker's makes it easy to save while you shop, whether it's in-store or online, so you get the most value out of every trip, every time. Download the Baker's app now to save big on your next purchase. Baker's, fresh for everyone. Must have a digital account to redeem offers. Restrictions may apply. See site for details.